Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How are you doing today?
Great.
It's great to see you. Great to be in the house of the Lord. I want to invite you to just go ahead and stand with me and let's go ahead and start worshiping the Lord this morning. Do you love the Lord?
Amen.
He's the reason for the season, but it's a lot more than just a season. It's an all year round thing. You know, I just love that the Lord will never leave you unsatisfied. When you come to Him, whatever you need, He is a reservoir full of whatever you need at any moment and any time in our lives. I tell you, I just couldn't live without the presence of the Lord in my life. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So let's just praise Him this morning. Lord, in the steps of the righteous.
few more to live with the touch of your hand, stronger each day. Show me your way.
Stronger each day.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Show me the way, Lord. Show me the way, Lord, to draw near to you, to just get in your presence, to have encounter with you. No, but we need God every step of the way and every second of our lives. We're desperate for him. And aren't you glad he's there?
Amen.
All you have to do is just turn to him. And immediately you can have church right then. But you know there's anointings and then there's higher anointings. The Bible talks about going from glory to glory to glory. And maybe you're like me. I'm ready for one of those glory times. And I'm encouraged because we are living in a day when God is about to show up in a very big way. Amen.
Amen.
So just be anticipating it. Expect God to be big in your life. This morning, I'm going to preach a topic entitled, When the Ordinary Become Extraordinary. Amen. Maybe you're like I am. I just realize I'm just an ordinary, average, common man. That's who I am. But you know, God is able and has demonstrated all through the Bible that He takes ordinary people and does extraordinary things with them. In the 13th chapter of Acts, we're going to eventually get there, but not right now, because we know a lot about the Apostle Paul. We know that he came from a home, and he came from a culture and means that was quite extraordinary. His father was a Roman citizen, which meant that Paul grew up with security and privileges that the Christians that he was with did not have the privilege of. And he was given the very best education as a Pharisee because he was under the training of Gamaliel. Now, Gamaliel is the most prestigious Bible teacher and the teacher of the customs and the laws that ruled the life of a Pharisee. I mean, it was like going to Harvard. That's where he was at in his education. And we also know that Saul was picked by the Sanhedrin and entrusted. They entrusted him and gave him the assignment to bring the Christians under control. Those Christians had gotten out of control. And they weren't brought under control. And he was given the legal authority to punish them and punish them severely. And Saul passionately sought them out. He dragged the Christians out of their homes and he put them in prison to be persecuted, and he had them put to death also. And when he met Jesus and his life was radically changed in a moment, he becomes a great champion of the faith and a missionary to all the world, preaching the gospel of forgiveness of sin and salvation to all through Jesus Christ alone. So Paul had a radical change in his life when he met Jesus. But it's Barnabas that we don't know that much about. And I think of Barnabas as like an ordinary man that God accomplished extraordinary things through. And so I can sort of relate to Barnabas maybe a little more. And if God could do such extraordinary things through the life of Barnabas, well, perhaps he can do extraordinary things through our lives as well. So I want to spend a little time this morning getting more acquainted with the life of Barnabas. Barnabas is first mentioned in Acts chapter 4, verses 36 through 37, and he is described there as the son of consolation or encouragement. Now, that's not his real name. His real name is Joseph, but they gave him a surname, just like Jesus gave Peter a surname. His name is Simon, but Jesus called him Peter, which means a rock. And it's the same thing with Barnabas. Barnabas' name was Joseph, but they gave him a surname, which was about who he was to them. And his name is Son of Consolation or Son of Encouragement. How would you like to be? Oh, there comes Barnabas. You know, the guy who encourages us. You can't be around that guy without it rubbing off on us and making us feel a little bit better about ourselves. You ever been around people like that? Then that's a pretty nice gift. It's a whole lot better than being around someone, oh no, there comes whoever. Oh, I know what kind of bad things going on in her life. I can't wait to get away from her. I know I'm going to feel bad before I leave because that's all she's going to talk about. All he's going to be talking about is the bad things that are happening in the world. You know, I want to be around someone that makes me feel better. I want to be around someone that encourages me and builds me up and makes me feel like that the impossible is possible because God is with me. Amen? Amen. Well, this is who Barnabas was. Barnabas was. We see this in chapter 4 of Acts, verse 36 and 7. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money, and he put it at the apostles' feet. We see two very important characteristics about Barnabas right here in this short reading. And although his birth name was Joseph, he was fondly called Barnabas because he was a person who built people up when they were struggling and encouraged and strengthened them in the Lord. He's lovingly called the son of encouragement. Immediately we can tell then this is a man who's living life on the positive side of life with a great expectation from God of what the future might hold. He is full of the joy of the Lord, full of faith in God, a man full of thanksgiving and praise who has an anointing of joy that is contagious to others. If you're around him, it'll not be long before he's encouraging you and building you up in your faith of God. Barnabas is a positive person because God is a positive God. All things are possible in God. The Christian way is a positive way. It's not a way of, oh my, bad things are coming. Woe and misery unto all of us. That is not the gospel. That is not the good news. That is not what God has. The Lord said, I know my thoughts towards you. He said, I have plans. My thoughts and my plans for you are not to curse you, but they are to bless you and to prosper you and to bring about an expected end. In other words, I've got an expectation that something good that I have planned for you is going to come forth. Barnabas understood this, and this was what fueled him, energized him, and dominated his personality. But in the next verse, we learn something else about Barnabas. We find also that he is a man who is generous to God and who is generous to others. I remember the story of a rich young ruler who came to Jesus and he said, Master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, well, you need to keep all of the law. And he started talking about the commandments. And that young fellow said, I've done all these since my birth. And then Jesus said, there's one thing that you lack, young fellow. One thing, just one thing. Sell all that you have and come and follow me. And then the Bible says that he turned away and he was very sorrowful. He's very sorrowful because the Bible says that he was a man that had great wealth. See, his security was in his wealth. But we find out something about Barnabas. Barnabas' security was not in his wealth, and it was substantial because it was substantial enough that the Bible in Acts actually makes note of it. He sold a piece of property. And he brought all the money of it and he gave to the church. See, the church had just gotten filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and they were having encounter experiences with God, and their numbers were radically and dramatically increasing every day. And there were people getting healed, and there were people getting delivered. I mean, wonderful and amazing things were going on. And people were just so excited about the Lord that they quit their jobs. All they wanted to do was sit at the feet of the apostles and learn about Jesus. There was a period and time of great revival that was going on. And I tell you, when people are having that type of encounter, they're not too concerned about work. They're not too concerned about anything. They're hungry for the things of God. We're going to see this happen again. It's coming. Again. And I believe it will come in this generation. But that also creates some problems, doesn't it? You need food to feed people. When people quit their jobs because they want to minister to others, because they feel the tug of God upon their heart to just do nothing but serve in the things of the kingdom of God, the bills still have to be paid. So he saw a need, and what did he do? He responded by selling that which he had, and he gave it freely to God. So we see that not only is he a man who has the joy of the Lord dominating his life and an anointing of faith in him that expects good things from a good God and good things out of others, but he's also a man that is completely sold out to God. He just sold. The Bible didn't say he sold everything, but it says he sold that thing. And he gave it to the Lord. The next mention of Barnabas is found in Acts chapter 9. So let's begin reading in the 26th verse of the 9th chapter of Acts chapter 9. Acts 9, 26. When he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple. This is talking about Saul. See, Saul had gotten saved. And Saul was in Damascus. And they tried to kill him. So he came back to Jerusalem after he escaped there. And he tried to go to see the apostles, the believers. But they were what? Scared out of him. They knew who he was. They'd already experienced his hand of persecution. And now this is the new Saul, the redeemed Saul, who's come back to Jerusalem. And they didn't believe that he really was a disciple. Verse 27. But Barnabas took him in and brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord, and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. Barnabas is also a man of discernment. Barnabas sees in Saul a man who has been transformed by the power of God. And while others are seeing through the eyes of fear, Barnabas is seeing through the eyes of God. May we all see others through the eyes of God. Not the eyes of judgment, nor the eyes of resentfulness, nor the eyes of fear. But we need to see others through the eyes of God. Barnabas makes sure that the spiritual leaders, the disciples, the apostles as we know them, also see what the Lord has shown him. He presents Saul to the other disciples and he defends him to them by telling Saul's story of conversion. And it is this bold action of Barnabas to defend Saul and present his case before the disciples that gains Saul acceptance with the Christians there. And without Barnabas, the story of Saul might have turned out very differently. It's important that you and I listen to the Spirit of God and hear His voice through all the noise and all the distraction so that we can discern the gifts and callings of others, even when their reputations have been ruined by their past sins. We're about to enter into the greatest revival of repentance that this world has ever known. We must have a spiritual discernment to see beyond past transgressions and see the new creation that is being born again in Jesus Christ, because the sinners are coming. They are coming to Jesus by the thousands in the near future. We need to get a hold of this truth because we've got to get ready for them. Do we see the best in others and expect good to come from them? When we project an expectation to others that God is transforming their lives and shaping them in His own image, we encourage others and give them the power to put their faith in God and believe God to do so also. In other words, believe God to make the expectation that God has given us come forth. You know, we can put an expectation of failure on others. I'll believe it when I see it. That's an expectation of failure. I expect that person to fail because they always did before. But when Jesus encounters a person, He changes them from the inside out. They're a new person. And we have to get beyond their past transgressions to look and see what God sees in them, so that we can help them get beyond that into the new life which God has birthed them into. Amen? Amen. The next opportunity for us to discover something about Barnabas comes when news comes to the church leaders in Jerusalem of a great revival in Antioch, where the Greek Gentiles are getting saved. So they send Barnabas to investigate and send them a report. Acts chapter 11, verses 9 through 30 tell us this story. We're not going to read all of that, but I'm going to read a portion of it. Beginning with the 22nd verse. News of this reached them in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. When he arrived and saw that the grace of God had done, he was glad and encouraged them all to remain true to the Lord with all their hearts. He was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith, and a great number of people were brought to the Lord. Immediately we see four distinct qualities of him. Barnabas was a good man. You know, we have a choice. We can be a good person or we cannot be a good person. It takes deciding that we're going to make right choices in critical moments in order to be identified as a good man. But not only was he a good man, and maybe because of this, he was filled with the Holy Spirit, the Bible says. Full of the Holy Spirit. It wasn't a process of being filled or having that initial encounter with God. No, but he was a man who was all the time full of the Spirit of God. Sometimes we rest on our laurels because we had some type of experience with God sometime in our past. But you know, that's really not important. What is important is, what do you have now? What's in you now? What's in me now? Well, he was full of the Spirit of God. And he was full of faith. I've known people who had a good relationship with God, but they had a bad outlook on the future. They're not full of faith. That's also a choice that we've got to make. I'm going to believe the Lord. How about you? I'm going to believe the Word of God. What about you? I'm going to trust in God and expect that good things are the good things that he said he was thinking about me are coming forth. Amen. Because I know that's what his heart is. If God wants to be good, if God wants to bring good into my life, why should I let my attitude and my words keep them from coming? No, I want to be full of faith. I want to have an expectation that God is as good as his word. He's going to do exactly what he said. And I can depend upon that for my present and my future. And then lastly, Barnabas loved people. You know, I heard someone talk about that the number one quality that made a great soul winner is that you had to love people. If you just love people with the love of God, really love them, then it makes, that's the most essential quality of being a soul winner. Well, he must have loved people because look at this. With an anointing on his life, he led a great number of people to the Lord. He was an evangelist, had an evangelist anointing. And he didn't lead them to the Lord by putting them down. He led them to the Lord by leading them into the goodness and grace of God. Because he said when he got there, he was full of joy. Because he had seen what the grace of God had done. Amen. There again is that positive attitude. It's that joy of the Lord. It's that faith in God that sets him apart. And it is here that we see the next character, strength of Barnabas. He recognizes the gifting and anointing upon Saul's life, and he goes and finds him and brings him back to Antioch. This is verse 25. Then Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul. When he found him, he brought him to Antioch. So for a whole year, Barnabas and Saul met with the church and taught great numbers of people. The disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. So Barnabas mentors Saul. He makes him his co-partner in the ministry and spends a whole year helping Saul mature and shaping him into the man that God will use like few others in the history of humanity. But I got a feeling that the Apostle Paul, as he would soon be called, owes much to the son of encouragement, Barnabas, for the success that he had in his life. You know, Paul, he was kind of a straight shooter. Paul, he could cut you right down to the ground with his words. He sort of had a different type of personality. Don't you think he learned something by spending a year with Barnabas? Initially, I think a lot of the grace and the joy and the faith that was on Barnabas got taught to Paul. You know, if you're around people, their anointing comes upon you. If you just hang around the right people, you'll become to think like them. You'll a lot of times you'll look like them and you'll act like them. You get something of the anointing that they have that comes upon you. And it was also here that the new believers got their name as Christians because there was such a transformation in their lives that it was clear before the whole world that they had been with Jesus and had been born again and radically, radically changed in their natures. I remember when I was radically changed in my nature. Do you? When we got saved, we got born again. Maybe some of y'all weren't. You know, as far as the world was concerned, I wasn't a bad sinner when I got saved. But I knew the hidden ways of my life. I knew the secret sins in my life. I knew I was lost and undone and without hope in the world until Jesus saved me of my sins. But I'm glad that after I got saved, I had someone that would encourage me. Someone that would build me up. I had a Barnabas in my life. And it made all the difference in the formation of my young Christian life. It made me hunger for God, hunger to be more like the one who was mentoring me and encouraging me in the Lord. It took my focus on what I was losing, because I did lose a lot of friends. I did lose a lot of prestige as far as the world is concerned, because I wasn't interested in the things of the world anymore. I wanted to do the things of God. I wanted to be pleasing to God. It's always going to cost you when you give up the old things, but you want to put on the new things. But you know what God will do? He'll give you other friends. He'll give you other anointings, other projects, things that are important to you to fill up the void of what you've had to give up. God always gives us more than we give up. Well, I want to conclude today's sermon by talking about the importance of what happens in chapter 13. I'm going to read a few verses there. Chapter 13, I'm going to begin reading with verse 1. Now, in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manian, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. And while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. And then verse 4, the two of them sent on their way by the Holy Spirit. That's just a portion I want us to emphasize here. Looking at the function of the prophets here, we can see they were praying, they were fasting, they were worshiping the Lord. But then the Holy Spirit speaks to the prophets and gives specific prophetic words, specific instruction. The Holy Spirit tells them to set apart Barnabas and Saul for the work to which he has called them. Is there anything in the world that you and I need more than to know what is the work to which God has called us and to be about doing it? Amen. Jesus himself said, "I must be about my Father's work." He understood that we have a mission in life and that God has given us an anointing to fulfill it. So they were set apart with the impartation of authority and given the power of the Holy Spirit and sent forth for the service to which the Holy Spirit had called them to. They laid hands on them and ordained them and sent them on the way by the Holy Spirit's rhema word and abiding peace. So there is a setting apart under service and an anointing by the Holy Spirit to accomplish it. In the early New Testament church, there was an abundance of the rhema word of God. The ministry of an apostle and prophet was fully functioning in the church. But in my Christian life, especially the earlier part, there was a famine of the rhema word of God until the past few years, maybe the last 10 years or so. But presently, especially in this, I said past year, but in this present year, it is evident that the offices of prophet and apostle have been freshly activated by God, and there is an abundance of the prophetic rhema word that is guiding the body of Christ. I want you to know it's just everywhere. There used to be a famine. It used to be unheard of that there was a person who had the gift of prophecy and would be able to speak forth to really bring direction and edification and encouragement to the body of Christ. But this is prevalent. If you have the interest to look, you will find those who will tell you what it is that the Spirit of God is saying to the body of Christ in this time. And it's amazing how many different voices of prophets are available to be heard. I think the internet has really brought things to our fingertips like no other generation before. Maybe they've been there, but we didn't hear it. We weren't in their presence. We weren't associated with them. But I tell you what, God is alive, He is real, and He is doing a profound work in this generation. And He is speaking through the voices of His prophets. In fact, the Bible says that God does nothing on the earth that He does not first speak to His prophets about. And then He says, blessed and blessed are they who hear the voices of the prophets. I've made up my mind. I do not intend to be on the side line watching the movements of God. I intend to be a part of the movement of God. Whatever God is doing, I want to be in it and of it. Amen. And I'm excited about what is before us. But you know, this is nothing more than a talking about the prophetic rhema that's coming out of the prophets. It's nothing more than a foreshadowing of the greatest revival ever to come upon the earth that is soon to come. I believe with all my heart that we're living in the last days, but also in the most exciting days imaginable for true believers. God is coming in His glory with signs and wonders so that the world will see His love for them, and many are going to come into the kingdom of God. Get ready, church, for when this great anointing comes to the church, it will be the easiest thing for you to pray for the sick and see them get well. Very much like what Kenneth Hagin said at the beginning of the faith movement in the 40s, in the late 40s. He said, and during that time, he said anybody could pray for someone who was sick and they would see the miracle of God of healing. Aren't you looking forward for that to come again? Amen. You know, we've persevered and we've strove and we've worked hard in the faith of God and trusted His word and believed on Him. But some of these things have not come easy, but they're going to. When the glory of God comes, these things will be easy. Multitudes will be drawn by the spirit of conviction and fall down before God and receive Him with all their hearts. We're going to see an army of young people who are sold out to God, who love Him with all their heart, and they're going to be full of the Holy Spirit, and they're going to be full of the power and the love of God. They're going to do incredible things. A great awakening in America is soon coming. We must prepare ourselves to be flowing with God in spirit, and ready to help mentor, teach, and bring to maturity all the babies that are soon to be born into the kingdom of God. Don't you know that babies have to be tended to? Babies have to be tenderly and lovingly helped, nurtured, and matured. We're going to be there in place to help bring them to maturity. Something amazing happens when Paul and Barnabas are on this first missionary trip. They always go first to the temple to minister, And then afterwards they go out into the city and they minister to the Gentiles. But while that they're at the temple there in Antioch, there's such a crowd that keeps coming. I mean, the people are so hungry that the Jewish leaders, they become jealous and they start creating trouble and strife and division. And as a result, Paul and Barnabas turn their focus completely on the Gentiles. And the world is changed forevermore by their ministry to us, the Gentiles. It happens right here at the end of chapter 13. I'm going to pick it up at the 46th verse. Then Paul and Barnabas answered them boldly. We had to speak the word of God to you first. But since you reject it and do not consider yourselves worthy of eternal life, we now turn to the Gentiles. For this is what the Lord has commanded us. I have made you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth. When the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and honored the word of the Lord, and all who were appointed for eternal life believed. This is very significant and important to you and I. Because not only had God already told the apostles and the Jewish church, he told them, do not call unclean that which I have called clean. In other words, he told them, you are to accept the Gentile Christians as equal brothers and sisters with you. But now there's something actually more important that is coming, and that is that this great gospel of peace and grace has been turned as a focus onto the Gentiles. And we are the benefactors. We have benefited from that. Amen. You and I actually have benefited because Paul turned his attention under the admonishment of the Holy Spirit. He turned his attention to the Gentile nation. Hallelujah. You know, God is such a good God. I want to be a person. When I'm around you, I build you up. If I can't give you something good, I'm not going to give you something bad. Amen? I want to help someone on this road to glory. I want to help someone make it to heaven and be successful along the way. What about you? Hallelujah. I tell you what, God took an ordinary man called Barnabas and he did extraordinary things through him. Because he was sold out to the Lord. And he had the joy of the Lord as a countenance. And he believed that what God said, he would do. He was as good as his word. Just as the Bible says, that what the promises of God are yea and amen. You don't see anything negative. You don't see, well, maybe or sometimes. No, that's not what the Bible says. It says the promises of God are yes, and they are amen. Amen? Hallelujah. Well, before we close, I want us to have a chance to have prayer one for another. And I wonder if you have a special need that we, as the church, need to pray for. And I'm giving you an opportunity to speak that out right now. Does anyone have a special need that we need to pray for during this closing prayer? I know that we've already prayed for Mr.
Billy McDaniel.
We're going to continue to pray for him. Billy McDaniel. Are there any other prayers?
It's from member Pat Bowden. I heard that she has cancer.
Pat does.
Pat's just on some aggressive treatments. So
okay. I know Pat well. I did not know that. So we'll be praying for Pat Bowden as well.
Keep Karen, my sister, in prayer, just her situation.
Okay. Let's pray for Karen. Amen.
Continue to remember Todd.
Let's continue to remember Todd. Amen. Yes?
I would like to give a testimony.
Okay. Let's get the rest of our requests and then
But I want Juanita to be remembered.
Juanita.
Debbie's mother.
Okay. Oh, yes, of course. Any other prayer requests? Amen.
There are several people I understand at Hopton High School that has COVID.
Yes.
So let's keep them in prayer.
And it's popping up throughout our schools. It's popping up throughout our schools.
Pastor King, Crystal too, her sister's grandbaby, 11 days old, and he's hooked. I don't know exactly what's going on, but he's hooked up to all these things, and they're asking for prayer.
Okay. We're going to have prayer for these, and then we're going to have a testimony. Is that okay, bro? Now, if you made a request for someone to be healed, because I just don't remember everybody. I will miss it for sure. I want you to stand up. I want you to stand up. If you made a request for someone, I want you to stand up. Okay? That's good. Hallelujah. And you make sure you pray to God concerning the request that you made, and that way we'll cover everything without any problem. I'm just going to leave in prayer. Father, we trust you. We trust your power. We trust your glory. We trust the desire of your heart to heal, to deliver, to bring good things into the life of people. And Lord, we notice in the Bible that when a request was made to Jesus, he did not turn them away. Lord, he said, bring them to me. And he healed everyone. Lord, and we know that is the desire of God this morning, to heal those among us who are sick, to heal those that we're associated with, the names that have been given, who are also sick. Lord, we're just so grateful for your healing hand upon each and every one. Hallelujah. Lord, it's so good to see Tony and Sharon here. We're so grateful for you healing them, but what we know, it's not finished. We pray that you complete your healing in all of their family, Lord, for what they have been through. Father, Brother Albert is not here, and he's not here because he's not feeling well this morning. Lord, we pray you would heal him as well. Lord, and all the other ones that request is made known for. Lord, we agree with these that are standing representing them. Lord, that you will completely heal and restore each and every one. Move, Lord, into their life by the power of the Holy Spirit and minister the anointing of healing into them. Lord, may they give glory to God for whom it is only due. We love you, Lord, and we praise you, and we give the glory for all of these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated, except you, sir. You got a testimony.
Yeah, and I want to turn around and look at the congregation.
That's good.
I don't know exactly how to share this with you. And I know my wife is worried, and she's always worried about what I might say sometimes. But y'all have been in the presence of a healing this morning, even though you don't know it. I've had some problems with my finger. I ain't been able to shut it. Look at that.
Amen.
Now my wife put some, what you call that stuff? You put on for sweating and inflammation and stuff. Well, I come in church this morning and I sit down right, and the preacher got talking about doing things the way the Lord having to do, that you bring joy to people. And I just sit there and I said, Lord, I said, you know, I'm sitting right here with fingers that's hurting. And I asked you to heal. And I took my hand and went around that finger. And I said, God, anoint this finger. Not that it be healed right that moment, but when I got ready to go out of church, it would be healed. So I stand this morning before you, saying to you that God is Almighty God. And it don't matter what the circumstances is, God can heal it, whether it be your finger, whether it be your heart.
Amen.
No matter what it is.
Yes.
I too like to glorify God while I'm standing here saying to my family, I love them with all my heart. I know I'm aggravating to them, but I still love them. And I'm so grateful for my family.
Amen. Amen. You know, I remember the first healing that I ever experienced, and it would sound so insignificant to you. But have you ever been asleep and bent your ear the wrong way? And woke up with that thing just killing you? Well, I did that as a young Christian, and I just started saying, Lord, help me, help me. And the Lord just took all that pain right away. But you know what? It's so seemingly insignificant to the world, but not when it's you. Not when it's you. The little bit of a hangnail can torment your body. It doesn't matter if it's a small thing or a big thing. It's the same God. And it's the same power of the God that heals and delivers us and ministers to our every need. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Love you all. Thank you for coming today. Have a blessed and wonderful week.